The trombone's sound starts with the player blowing into the mouthpiece whilst vibrating their lips. The player can alter the sound by changing the size of the opening between their lips and also by adjusting the length of the tube the air passes through using the slide. The longer the tubing, the lower the pitch. Some trombones also have valves to direct air through extra lengths of tube, giving access to even more notes. The mellow sound comes out through the bell, which acts as a simple amplifier. A team of 8 technicians lovingly handcraft these instruments, taking up to 90 hours on each one. They're all passionate musicians. A bass trombone is made of 91 parts and almost 3 meters of brass tubing. It all starts with the bell. Cornet player Dave Johnson is in charge of crafting them.
Some people may say that it's one of the most important parts of the instrument.
The raw material for the bell is a flat sheet of brass. Dave begins by cutting the shape of the bell's spout from the flat metal. The piece is then hammered into a rough form. The sides now need to be rolled and connected to form a conical tube. Smooth sides won't hold together, so Dave first cuts out small teeth to help them grip, then closes the two edges. To stop them from coming apart, Dave uses a process called brazing, filling the gap with a mix of molten silver, copper, and zinc.
The braze obviously is the glue, if you like, that keeps it attached together.
The uneven spout needs shaping. And that means Dave uses brute force to mold it over a hardened steel bell shape. Next, Dave has to make the widest part of the bell, known as the flare. He takes another sheet of unpolished brass and uses the lathe to put a smooth curve into the flat disc. The flare can now be finished and trimmed, but it still has to be connected to the spout. Dave uses a hammer with a specially shaped metal head called a planishing hammer to press the two pieces of brass together. Then he brazes them. It's starting to look a lot like part of a trombone. The company's been making trombones here since 1995. Alan Brown's been a part of the team for 9 of those years. Today, he's finessing the inner slide.
If you look around the factory, you'll see there's no computerized machinery. It's all old-fashioned stuff.
Alan must make a tube that is just 0.2 millimeters, or 2 hairs' widths, narrower than the outer slide. You can't buy precision like that, so they make them themselves. A 60-year-old broaching machine, originally used in a nearby colliery, has been given a second life and modified to do the job.
This used to be down in the coal mines as a boring machine.
A steel rod called a mandrel is placed inside the brass tube. The geared broaching machine pulls the tube with the mandrel inside through a tungsten carbide die with a force of 36 tons. Brass is softer and more malleable than the mandrel and the die, so it squashes like toothpaste into the tiny space in between, creating a longer, thinner pipe.
If you look at that, you can see that it's almost double its length.
The straight lengths of pipe are finished, but they won't make any music like this. They must now be joined to their curved ends. That's a job for the soldering team, who use a tin and silver solder. Brass is an alloy of copper and zinc. It's relatively easy to mold and work with. Tom Wellings has been making trombones for 11 years.
Some people might say that the trombone's
a novelty instrument because of the stereotypical trombone gliss, but I can assure you that it's not.
The trickiest bit of a trombone to make is the valve section. The company makes 10 different models of trombone, from the highest pitched alto to the lowest pitch contrabass. To play the lowest notes, air must pass through more tubing, directed using finger and thumb operated valves. Tom is putting the final touches on the valve section for a bass.
It's a cross between jewellery and plumbing.
But however skillful Tom is, he won't know if his trombone is a diamond or a dud until he puts it to the test.
I'm just setting it up so I can blow it and make sure it's in tune.
He's one of three trombone players that work here, who give every instrument a personal pop of approval. Each trombone must produce certain notes in different set positions, and each note has to be a semitone apart. So to produce a harmonious sound, the instrument needs to be fine-tuned. The red light on the tuner shows this one is slightly out.
I'm going to have to shorten this section of valve wrap.
With the length of valve wrap shortened, the trombone is now in tune and Tom's work is done.
It's ready to pre-polish.
After multiple stages of cutting, heating and cooling, the brass is tarnished. And the trombone is the pride of a brass band, so they need to make sure it sparkles. To buff it up to an even shine, the parts get a brush from these polishing machines. And any hard-to-reach corners are sorted with a strip of rag and good old-fashioned elbow grease. The trombone's looking good, but if they left the metal bare, it would soon tarnish again. And with these instruments costing up to £10,000, you don't want that. So the finishing touch is a layer of clear lacquer to protect it for the future. The lacquer is sprayed on and dried. This leaves the metal bright and tough enough to face a lifetime of brass band recitals, even on the rainy streets of Yorkshire.